So while the presentation loads, I want to tell you something about myself and what I'll be talking about today. My name is Vaibhav, and I started a company that creates humorous products and services. I graduated from IIT Bombay 6 years ago, and then I worked for a couple of years as a consultant with McKinsey. And then, as you know, I had an offer from the Harvard Business School. So at that point of time, I also had an inclination, a desire to do something of my own. And it's recommended that you do something either in a field which will get you a lot of money, or you do something related to something that you feel really strongly about, that you really like. I feel strongly about three things primarily: heavy metal, looking shady, and humor. Very hard to make a living off of heavy metal because Black Sabbath and Metallica already did it. Very hard to make a living off of looking shady unless you're Tahir Shah. And it's pretty hard making a living off of humor, but that was like the only option I had left. So at that time, about 3.5-4 years ago, I decided to take the plunge and do my best to start a company that did something related to humor. And in my mind, my clarity of thought was just that: something related to humor. If any of you ever start something of your own, please give it more definition and clarity than that. It'll help you and save 1.5 years of your life. This is true. So I talked about taking the plunge, right? The reaction of most of the world, and I'm taking neighbors as a proxy for most of the world, because they certainly know more about you than most of the world. So before that, when I was an engineer and a consultant and going to be a business school grad, neighbors approved of me. Older neighbors discussed or inquired discreetly if I was available to marry the offspring of their offspring. I didn't look like this then. It helped. Sadly, after I decided to start up, that approval changed entirely, because in terms of social acceptability, starting up is much higher on the scale today than it was a few years ago. And starting up in the humor space was way down, right? In terms of social acceptability. I think if I'd been a murderer, and one of those murderers who comes on the news fairly often, I'd have been much more approved of by most of the world. At that point of time, what did I have that helped me take the decision? I had a healthy dose of stupidity that really helped. But more than that, you need support from people who matter. For me, it was parents and friends initially. My parents had no problem with it. And I have no clue why. I don't have children, obviously. If I did, and one of them wanted to start up in the humor sector instead of going like a good South Indian boy to business school, I would probably order a full brain scan. But my parents supported me. And my friends thought I was insane, but they didn't tell me, which is kind of them. A lot of people who start up, some of you who start up, will also have to discuss it with your better halves, your girlfriends or your boyfriend. I must thank IIT Bombay here, because IITB ensured over 5 years that I had no such ties and kept me entirely girlfriend free. So that was one additional permission that I did not have to take, that made it much easier for me to take the plunge. Some of you will not be so lucky, but you are in an engineering college, so some of you will be so lucky. That was why I started, I think. And I'd like to talk about a few things that I encountered during my journey in the hope that it will resonate with some of you. This is a nice picture of zombies that has nothing much to do with what I'm going to say, but it has zombies, so it's cool. The first thing I encountered immediately after starting up was the lack of comfort. And I want to explain that. Obviously, when I was at IIT, there was not much comfort because I lived in a hostel. You guys live in a hostel, you know what hostels are. But at McKinsey, it was all AC and cars and 5-star hotels and bright light. Startups aren't that. There's not much of that at all. And if you're starting up in a field that you know nothing about, which is another thing that some of you should probably steer clear of, learn what you're going to do before you do it, or be super excited about. Because we started off, we didn't know much about humor except that we liked it, which again is not a great way to start. But we initially wanted to sell humor as a service to brand. And given that no brand knew about or cared about us, I took it upon myself, because I was the only person, to go and personally meet 300 brands over 4 months, right? And if you have to meet 300 brands, 300 companies over 4 months in Mumbai, you're probably going to end up traveling a lot by local train. I did 4 hours on local train every day. I don't know how many of you know about the local trains of Bombay, but their chief characteristic is their concentration of armpits. It's like cubic close packing or hexagonal close packing, whatever has the highest packing ratio. It's like that. And it's not even logical, right? So I am 6 inches taller than the average Indian male, but I still had 8 armpits in my face at any given point of time, which is hard. So that lack of comfort was something which was telling, and it was initially not very easy to take. And you'll have to ensure that when you do something of your own, you feel strongly enough about it that you're able to deal with the rest. So I think that was probably lesson one for me. Lesson two, people. Initially, when I was at IITB, I worked primarily with people like myself. And by the way, that's another characteristic. Anyone from IIT will somehow bring the conversation around to the fact that they're from IIT. If you're telling them that the stars are very bright today, they'll say, ah, that reminds me of a time when a star performed in the open air theater in my IIT. But that's a separate conversation. I think in college, you deal mostly with people like yourself, because those people gravitate together. And when you start up, when you go out and do something of your own, when you work anywhere, you deal with many different people. But when you're doing something of your own, you're the office boy or office girl, you're also the CEO. So you'll have to deal with a very great variety of people. And I think it was pretty humbling initially to see many entrepreneurs who are more accomplished than myself and see the amount of work they put in every day to get their stuff done. And that for me was very, very motivating. And it was something I had no idea about. And there's one more thing about people that I learned initially that I was fortunate. If you're starting something off, ensure that there are 3 or 4 of you for whom the idea is above anything else. So the success of the company or the idea trumps everything else in terms of personal goals or career goals or anything. Everyone needs to be wedded to that decision for a minimum of 3 to 5 years. If you have that, it'll ensure that you get over everything difficult, and that you'll never have more than minor difficulties. It should be, you know, like you're the president of the US and the number one thing on your mind is the fate of the world. Of course, if you're the current president, the number one thing is probably fighting with people on Twitter. But in general, ensure that you have people who care about the company in the court. I talked a little bit about clarity earlier. Since we were starting off in an area which wasn't very developed, even today, humor as an industry is confined to stand-up comedians who do really well and movies, funny movies. But there isn't really a humor industry. There aren't 10 types of companies, right? So if any of you are starting up in a sector which either doesn't exist or isn't fully formed, be prepared to go through several iterations of your idea. These are just like half of the things that we've probably done. Started off wanting to do something funny. I'm glad we evolved from there. Otherwise, I'd be under a flyover today. And we evolved through all these till we got to humor and education. I'll talk about that in a second. But I'll talk about an interesting pit stop along the way, which is when we wrote humor for politics or against politics, depending on which side of the spectrum you were on. That was a great learning experience, right? Very challenging, very hard to do because it has to be real time. Sometimes very disheartening, because you can work super hard when you're doing political humor, write the funniest stuff, create the funniest video, whatever. But you'll be destroyed, you'll be blown off stage by just a 5-minute unedited clip of a stupid politician just talking, right? So you'll never get as good as that or as funny as that. But we did that. It was a great learning experience. Though at the end of it, we got paid slightly later than promised. Though if we were expecting to be all promises to be fulfilled, we were probably going to the wrong kinds of clients with that sector. So we ended up with, as I said, Laugh Guru, which is a lot of what we do today, which is humor in education for children. And as part of that, so this is where, as a company, we know what we're doing. It took us, you know, a while to get there, a year and a half. Now we know what we're doing. We know who our clients are. We know how to service them and so on. I want to talk briefly here. The story isn't as interesting as that would have you believe. But I want to talk briefly here about two extremely weird but great fun stories that we've dealt with while working with this product, right? And these make the startup journey a lot of fun because, yes, you work much harder than people in other jobs, but if you're doing something entrepreneurial, a lot of funny stuff comes up that wouldn't come up anywhere else at all, like the first example. So LaughGuru is aimed at kids primarily, and they can use it online through the power of the internet or on an offline pen drive that works without the internet. And there was this one parent, and this one parent kept insisting that she be given a pen drive for her son, who was in the fourth grade. And usually if they tell us once, we aren't super bright, but we understand. When someone says, I want a pen drive, we give them a pen drive. But she told us 5 or 6 times, she would call our customer care and say, I want a pen drive at 11:30 at night. And when our customer service executives called her and said, ma'am, welcome to our family, when our customer service executive called, she replied with, I want a pen drive. So she was like a zombie saying, give me pen drive, I will give you freedom. But yes, so that was her. So I asked the person who sold it to her, I said, can you find out what's behind this unhealthy obsession with pen drives? Does her family own like shares in SanDisk or something? Just figure it out. And so the person asked, like he inquired, and he came back saying that was a very sad story. And I was like, if someone tells you it's a very sad story, you have to ask them the entire story, right? So I asked what was behind this insistence on a pen drive. So apparently there was another brother, like, who was in the 9th grade. He's still alive. He's in the 9th grade. And apparently they lived in a small town. This is what the guy who sold it to them tells. So then I said, okay, maybe they don't have a super fast internet. Can I understand it's a pen drive? So he's like, no, they have a super fast internet connection. Like all you big city people just judge us, but we have fast internet. So then I said, okay, what was the problem? So this 9th standard kid apparently had done what a lot of 9th standard red-blooded youth do, especially when given high-speed internet, empty houses, and gone and researched more on human biology than was strictly in his syllabus, also on chemistry between two or more individuals. As a result of that, net had been outlawed in that house indefinitely. And so they wanted a pen drive. And then the person who sold it to them ended with this is so bad. And then I went in 2 seconds from like an entrepreneur to a moral science teacher and I said, yes, it is very bad. Then I put the phone down and I wondered what world I had got in. So these are great, insane stories that make life as an entrepreneur much easier to live. There's also people who just don't get it. I talked about spectrum of people earlier. And there was someone who was being interviewed, I think, on WhatsApp, right? And she replied to the person who wanted to interview her and said, at what time will it be convenient for us to interview you? She replied on WhatsApp saying, hi, there is a problem and I cannot be interviewed. So we thought maybe social anxiety, whatever, it's okay. And we said, is there another platform that is convenient? But she said, no, the reason I cannot be interviewed is because I do not have WhatsApp. And then it was very difficult to explain to her that if she was messaging a person on WhatsApp, there was a probability equal to 1 that she probably had the app herself. And at the end of it, she didn't. She refused to accept that she had WhatsApp, even though we resorted to things like her sending us a screenshot of her phone. And we said, that right there, that icon is WhatsApp. So the lesson from this is people are crazy and you can either go crazy or laugh at them or a combination of the two, and a combination will probably end up happening. 2 more things I'd like to tell you and then I'd like to stop because it's a long day and I don't want you to throw stuff at me. Did engineering help at all I would say that it helped in two ways that I can think of, and I would say that most of my engineering education helped in these two ways, except one technical drawing course I did that didn't help at all. It sucked. It should be removed. But yeah, other than that, clearly the grade I got in that course was not very good. Engineering helped in two ways that I can remember. One, I think as engineers, any of us is trained to do pretty much anything or accomplish anything in one night. That's not necessarily good, but it's what we end up learning very well. And I'm not saying we're alone in that, but we definitely are trained to do that. So that helped a lot, because if you extend that infinitely, if you do that day after day, night after night, you'll probably have a successful startup, or you'll get sick and die, or both. Hopefully the former. The former is much nicer. And the second thing that probably helped me from engineering education was, I'm talking this slowly so that I can think of something, but the first really, really helped. And I'll come to the second in a while. But I would say that a lot of my education did help. I don't necessarily feel that I am not using what I learned. And that's important for you, because at this stage or down the line, a lot of you might think about changing career choice. But everything that you learn will come in use somewhere except PD. Finally, I'd like to leave you with some advice. Very simple, I think. If you have people whom you trust, take their advice, but don't take it very much. Take like a little of it. And everyone else, don't take their advice at all. And I can tell you this a lot of times, and it probably won't resonate with you as strongly as it will if you watch this 10-second video. So please watch this 10-second video. Okay, so yes, that was my reaction to. The movie is called Mega Shark versus Giant Octopus. It has three sequels, which also feature the Mega Shark. So spoiler, he doesn't die. You can never watch this movie now, you know the ending. But yeah, buy it legally, order a copy, or whatever kids do nowadays. But yeah, you should watch this movie because it's great. And you should learn about Asylum Films because they made these. And then they made the Sharknado series, which is slightly more mainstream than this one. And I'd like to leave you with some scenty and well-chosen words which make you feel grand and sad. But I can't. So thank you all for being here. I hope you had fun.